Hi folks, welcome back to Knitting with Kindred Spirits. I'm your host, Delina, and I am so thankful that you decided to come back and join me. I know that this video is gonna go up a little bit late, but I've been really busy the last 2 weeks. And as you all know, life sometimes just gets in the way. I am so pleased that we have had a couple new viewers and a couple new subscribers. I think we're up to maybe 16 now, which is really good. I was not expecting to have any, so I'm okay with 16. And I am so very thankful and excited that to share that we have a Knitting with Kindred Spirits podcast group on Ravelry. It's a place where I'd like everybody to be able to come and discuss their life if they want to, that they feel safe and welcome and warm, that if you guys have any information that you would like to know from me, or if you would like to have any type of segments or anything else on the podcast, that would be a great place to let me know. I did open up one thread that said, what would you like to see on this podcast? And if you could go in there and, you know, at least validate you kind of like what I'm doing so far, or give me some other information or something like that that you might like to know about myself or about my knitting journey or my crafting journey. This is a knitting, crafting, sewing podcast. I'm a little bit of a jack of all trades. I do dabble in a little bit of almost every type of handwork out there. So this isn't gonna be strictly Knitting with Kindred, but Knitting with Kindred Spirits just had a certain ring to it, so that's why I went with it. I do want to send out a couple thank yous to the young ladies that let me get the group up and running. I did not get permission to, come here, baby. Wish you come here. Come here. I did not get permission to reveal their names online, so I won't do that, but you know who you are, and I want to thank you very much. In particular, one of you sent me a very nice and heartwarming letter through Ravelry, and I appreciate it greatly that somebody else out there has, you know, the same thought process and different things like that. I'm going to grab our little friend here.
Sorry. My son. Oh, goodness.
See, sometimes she's not the nicest kitty. She's getting a little old and cranky. Come here. Come here. And if mommy smells a little different, she doesn't like that. I think she's going maybe a little blind or something. Come here, baby. Come here. And if it's not her idea, she doesn't like it. So I will probably cut that little bit out. Well, let's see. Let's get started. It's been about maybe 10 days since I filmed, maybe 14 now. Since the last time I filmed, I did do a few knitting projects, but they're nothing different than what they had been last week. I did have a couple trials and tribulations, which we will get into here in a little while. We did participate in that Down to the Wire, and we'll talk about that here. I did go home and visit my parents for Father's Day. I hope you guys had a very good Father's Day weekend. If it was, I hope you got to spend time with either your father, if he's still around, or at least the man that made you a mommy, if you got to be a mommy, or someone that you look up to that is a father figure. We can't exclude those people either, so. I did get to go home. I visited my parents just for a couple days. I was busy at the time with my mom, but then, and we had, my dad and I had lunch together that day. But then the man, he no longer does harvest himself, but he does work for a farmer out there because he's 79, so he's getting up there. But he'll run a truck back and forth from the small fields into the grain elevator for him and things like that. And it gives him a little spending money and whatnot. So dad got a call at lunchtime that said that they were getting ready to cut, which is harvest time, as it always is about Father's Day. Usually Father's Day through July 4th or around that was when we were always on harvest when I was a kid. So so dad was out harvesting most of the Father's Day weekend. We did get to eat lunch together on Saturday, and then we did eat lunch together on Sunday, but my brother and my sister-in-law didn't show up until a little bit later, so they missed out on lunch, but they got to eat afterwards. But my parents are much more early to bed, early to rise, definitely from the farming community, and the rest of us in the secular community have kind of slacked on that. And especially when it's your weekend. And my brother's a father too, and he wanted to spend some time with his son who had came home and things like that. And I'm not sure why Terrell didn't come to mom and dad's, but whatever, he's 26, he can decide whatever he wants to do. Unfortunately, mom and dad, grandma and grandpa might not be there for much longer, so he should take the advantage of spending as much time with them as possible, because sometimes those older people, no matter how much they drive us nuts, can lend a lot to our lives and can teach us a lot. So, well, kind of what I've got on the books for today is similar to what I've had the last few weeks. I don't have any finished knitting projects off the needles this past couple weeks, like I said, because it's been pretty busy, but I do have several sewing finished objects and different things like that. So let's go ahead and get started. I basically have been working on project bags. If you follow me on Instagram, you would kind of notice that I had posted a few photos, I believe yesterday, on there, and one was like a Star Wars. Well, I ran out of like lining stuff, and I was trying different types of lining, and I wasn't sure which one I wanted to use, because for my bags I like them kind of soft, but some people like them a little bit more firm. So and I don't know if any of you watch the Junk Yarn podcast, but Kemper even had, which this was so ironic because it was right after I had finished these bags, that she had posted her bag review on her podcast, and she was talking about how she liked it to be a little bit more stiff and a little bit more sturdy. And so I was just trying to figure out which area and genre and what I might want to put in the in my shop on Etsy. But this is one of the bags that I finished, and we are going to have a little bit of shadow today. I apologize for that. I have my like sheer curtains, which do have some stripe on them, pulled closed because it is awful sunny today and it was a little too bright, so I think that those needed to be closed. So there will be a little bit of shadow, but it's not too bad. Yeah, this was kind of a prototype that I was doing to see if I could figure out how to add the bottom part to the top part. This fabric is the same fabric that I sent to my swap buddy in Little Bobbin's Knits podcast when we did that the cozy cup swap, which was back in April, I think, March or April, something like that. That was the first swap I ever participated in. Hers is quite a bit smaller than this. This is what I would say would be a medium size. It would hold two cakes of yarn, of like Madeline Tosh size yarn, and your shawl project as you're working on it. This is the same size as that pink teacup one that I made last week, 2 weeks ago. So, but it kind of, when I was out driving to mom and dad's, I don't know if any of you are from the Midwest or anything like that, but the wheat fields are some of the prettiest time that you'll ever see Kansas. Especially right before they're cut, when they're kind of that golden, not marigold, but a golden russet color almost, some of them, and then some of them are lighter gold and some of them are just a gold. They're very pretty. They're just the different types of wheat that is grown out here, and we've had a lot of rain this past spring, in particular through May and June. That's partly why the last few years harvest has been done by the 1st of June. So we've started off a lot cooler than what we normally do, and so we've gotten a lot more rain and things like that, and all the trees are green, and the bushes and things like that were green. And then as I was driving out there, it was early morning, like 7:30, 8 o'clock, and the sky was a gorgeous blue. Of course, I was driving away from the sun because I was going west, and just the gold and the green and all of that, this is kind of what it made me think of. Just the different shades of gold and a little bit of the red, and then of course the blue from the beautiful sky. But the reason I picked this initially was because for her bag, I did a Wizard of Oz theme since I'm from Kansas, and kind of, and this is kind of the take off of the ruby slippers here, and little bit of the rainbow, but not really, and then of course her plaid dress. Now on the inside, I lined the last room with this, but I didn't have much of that left, so I just lined it with a light blue, which is complimentary. It looks fine. It's very pretty. So I will probably put this up for sale in the shop, maybe within the next week or so. It's not my greatest attempt, but it will do, and I'm not going to sell them for very much, maybe $14 or so. I think probably, I don't know, I haven't actually sat down and put the numbers to it, but this is the other side. So I think it's pretty. I got it from one of our local, this is actually the prettier side, one of our local fabric stores. It's called Cottonwood Quilts. So, and then one of the other ones I made is this one, which I love, and I have a feeling I'm going to keep it for myself. Maybe, I don't know. I have more fabric, so I can definitely make more. But it is a Paris theme one, and it's very shabby chic. That's one side, and that's the other. And then I also made a little Eiffel Tower pole. And it's also the kind that is a little bit bigger here, where you could use it on a small knitting needle as just a stitch marker instead of a progress keeper or a pull tab. But I just loved the little Eiffel Tower because it matched this so well. The difference in this one is it's a little bit more malleable. It's definitely softer. This one has polyfill lining for the interfacing type stuff. And it's like the polyester quilt batting, basically. So it's got a little bit more stiffness to it. This one is 100% cotton, and that's what I used on my pink one, with the teacups on it and stuff like that. And I like my bags to be kind of soft, because you can still, it will still sit up. See, it will still sit up on a table. I work out of mine all the time, but I like mine so I can kind of squish it into like a smaller place in my purse if I need to. And then I lined this with a really pretty green, and it kind of picks up the green right there, I guess, in that. And then the hot pink zipper, which I had to have. So I don't know, I will probably get the, I think to sell, people would probably like this better than mine, but than the soft one. So that's why I was thinking I would keep this one. But I love it. I think it is just adorable. And it is also a medium size one. And like I said, it holds two skeins in your work in progress. And then the final one that I did, I was trying out, I was gonna make an Amy Butler bag, I don't know, like 2 or 3 years ago, where, cause she had some, it was on Pinterest. That's where I found it. And I just fell in love with the silly bag. I have everything cut out. I just never made it. And I was going through my sewing room and, you know, like my supplies and stuff like that to see what I had. And I just wanted to try different things. The only thing I didn't have was iron-on fleece, which I need to get. I don't think Hobby Lobby has that. And that's the only, like, true craft store that we have around here. The quilt shop in downtown might have some, but I don't think so, because they would have more quilt batting than iron on fleece. But I know Joanna and Hancock's do, but I wasn't there, and I'm not going to be going to Wichita anytime soon. So I just was using what I had. But I decided to use some very stiff interfacing, which was actually what Amy Butler used on her bag. This is a large bag, and the next time I make this, I would like to change it a little bit. The gussets that I made to make it flat, because this will sit up. It will sit up on its own. There is no issue with that at all whatsoever. The only thing, if I make a large one again, because this was the first time I'd ever drafted, not the first time I drafted, but the first large bag I drafted. I just took this medium-sized bag that I drafted and made it bigger. The only difference is I would like to make the bottom gusset just a little bit wider. So it was probably, I think this is like two, oh no, this is probably about 4 inches. And I think I'd like the bottom guess it to be about 5 or 6 inches. So it had a bigger stance this way. Now I would say this would probably hold maybe 3 skeins, like half of a sweater's worth probably, and maybe the sweater. Because I mean, really, how often are you going to need all of the sweater's worth in one, like while you're going, like taking it with you and things like that. And then I also lined it with the red polka dot that I talked about before. I think this is adorable. I haven't decided what kind of fob that I'm going to put on it yet. I don't know if I'll put this one in the shop just yet. I'm going to go back and get some more of this fabric. The reason is I fell in love with a dress on Mod Cloth for my niece's bridal shower. They don't have it, and I don't know if they're going to be getting another one in. So it's a kind of an aqua color background with really pretty, almost roses like this. And actually, this would be kind of cute too as the dress. Be a little bit softer too. I don't know. Sorry. Squirrel. Magpie. Ooh, shiny. Anyway, the roses are a bit like this, and they have them all over, and they're so pretty. And this like maroon, magenta, pinky color is actually one of my favorite colors. If you can't tell by my house. But my sister-in-law, when I was showing her, I was showing them because I had gotten some men's fabric, and I was asking my brother. It's like, okay, I know that men are starting to knit more now, whether they're gay, straight, or whatever, doesn't really matter, but they're going to want bags too. So I picked up some Batman, two different kinds of Batman. I did get a Star Wars one. And then I found a Wonder Woman one that I absolutely love. It's not my normal cup of tea, but when I was a child, I loved Wonder Woman. I had the underoos, everything. Oh, so fun. And it also has Batgirl on it and somebody else, but I don't remember who that is. I don't have those sewn together yet. They're cut out, but it's not going to show the beauty of the fabric until they're sewn together. So maybe next time. But I was showing her this fabric, and Mom's like, well, why don't you just make your own? And I was like, well, I could, but I really want that fabric. And Valerie's like, well, that fabric's kind of like it, so why not go with that? So I thought that would be a cute, like, kind of 1950s A-line skirt with a cute top and maybe a sweater. So I'm definitely going to have to go back and get some more of this fabric. Even if I don't, I still think I would wear it to the bridal shower. I still think I want to buy it just to make a dress out of, because I think it would be super cute in the summertime. So those are my three finished projects that I've actually finished this past week. Actually just did that like Monday or Tuesday. So I'll tell you a little bit about what I'm drinking. It is raspberry cordial. For Caitlin's shower, we decided we're having it at a church because all of the other places are booked. I am not a drinker, but Caitlin wanted a little bit of a cocktail. But at the church, they won't serve cocktails because, of course, it's a church, which I completely understand. And I don't drink alcoholic beverages, but she still wanted something to be kind of special. So I was like, well, what about raspberry cordial? And my sister-in-law had no idea what I was talking about, but they're not Anna Green Gables fans like myself. So I went online, I went on Pinterest, and I just typed in raspberry cordial, and this recipe for a raspberry cordial spritzer came up. And it's actually supposed to be an alcoholic drink, but you don't have to have the alcohol in it. And oh, it is so good. Basically, all it is you make raspberry cordial, and then you use sparkling water. I think I'm going to use ginger ale instead of like seltzer water, because the seltzer water kind of had that Alka-Seltzer taste, but and I don't like that. But I think ginger ale would add just enough bite and the bubbles. And then you're supposed to use Prosecco with it, but of course we'll just leave that out. So we're gonna put it in one of those big tall, like tea jug type things with a little spigot. I think that's what we're gonna do. I'm not sure. And have like glasses and stuff that people can fill, and have like lemon slices in there just kind of floating on top with maybe some ice cubes and things like that. So I made up so Valerie could taste what raspberry cordial tastes like, because I wasn't gonna just go ahead and say no, we're gonna do this because it's really good. And so Valerie and Kyle were coming, so I was like, well, I'll make some up. And I only did a half recipe of it. And I've made raspberry cordial before, of course, when I was a child. I always wanted to, but Mom said, no, it's too much work, so I never did. But I think my first year out on my own in my own kitchen, like here, I made some. It turned out horrible. I didn't have the proper sieve. I didn't have any cheesecloth. So all I got was, I mean, it wasn't bad, but it was like, I still had the seeds in there. There was way too much pulp. It wasn't actually like raspberry juice. It was awful. So, but this is mighty, mighty tasty. So hopefully we won't get into too many shenanigans, just like Diana did when she drank her raspberry cordial. But I think I'm only going to have one glass full. She had three. I do have the recipe, and please do not report me to the copyright police, because I did not do this. When, I'm not exactly sure when Mom and Dad gave this to me. It must have been for Christmas or birthday or something. I don't remember. Or sometimes Mom would just give me things just because. And I have the original. It's in storage, and I have to move my entire entertainment center to get into there. So where all my other Green Gables, like book sets and things like that, are at. So it's kind of a pain, but this is, it's off, it's like got stuff all over it. It's a cookbook, and I've used it quite a lot since I've gotten it. I got it probably when I was maybe 13, probably. Yeah, probably 12, 13, something like that. And it was published, I believe, by, the Anna Green Gables, or the Lucy Maud Montgomery estate. And it has like little quotes and things like that from it. It's got the Cowcumber Boats, which these are just copies. My mom made a copy of it so I could keep the other in pristine condition and then actually use this as a cookbook. So I just took the cover off because it'd be easier. We've got Cowcumber Boats, Splendid Lettuce Salad, and there's dressing to go with it. Thick and creamy vegetable soup. And I've made probably most of these. I don't like cucumbers, so I didn't make the cowcumber boat. And then it comes with little illustrations as well. Isn't that neat? And then Diana Berry's favorite raspberry cordial recipe. If you would like this recipe, I can post it down below. It's super easy. It's not hard at all. It just takes some time. And if you want, you can also follow me on Pinterest, and I think I have the recipe on there as well, and I'll put all of that information down below. So basically, you use 2 packages of frozen unsweetened raspberries, 1 1/4 cup of sugar, and 4 cups of boiling water, and 3 lemons. I did not have any lemons, so I left those out, but it still tastes really good. So basically, you just boil this up with the sugar and the water and all of that. And then you strain it, and then you let the raspberry cordial cool and chill it in the refrigerator, and then serve it with a float of thin lemon in each glass. And it has a whole bunch of other really good recipes. To the copyright police, because I did not do this. I'm not exactly sure when Mom and Dad gave this to me. It must have been for Christmas or birthday or something. I don't remember. Or sometimes Mom would just give me things just because. And I have the original. It's in storage, and I have to move my entire entertainment center to get into there. So where all my other Anne of Green Gables like book sets and things like that are at. So it's kind of a pain, but this is, it's off, it's like got stuff all over it. It's a cookbook. And I've used it quite a lot since I've gotten it. I got it probably when I was maybe 13, probably. Yeah, probably 12, 13, something like that. And it was published, I believe, by the Anne of Green Gables or the Lucy Maud Montgomery estate. And it has like little quotes and things like that from it. It's got the Cowcumber Boats, which these are just copies. My mom made a copy of it so I could keep the other in pristine condition and then actually use this as a cookbook. So I just took the cover off because it'd be easier. We've got Cowcumber Boats, Splendid Lettuce Salad, and there's dressing to go with it. Thick and creamy vegetable soup. And I've made probably most of these. I don't like cucumbers, so I didn't make the cowcumber boat. And then it comes with little illustrations as well. Isn't that neat? And then Diana Berry's favorite raspberry cordial recipe. If you would like this recipe, I can post it down below. It's super easy. It's not hard at all. It just takes some time. And if you want, you can also follow me on Pinterest, and I think I have the recipe on there as well, and I'll put all of that information down below. So basically, you use 2 packages of frozen unsweetened raspberries, 1 1/4 cup of sugar, and 4 cups of boiling water, and 3 lemons. I did not have any lemons, so I left those out, but it still tastes really good. So basically, you just boil this up with the sugar and the water and all of that. And then you strain it, and then you let the raspberry cordial cool and chill it in the refrigerator, and then serve it with a float of thin lemon in each glass. And it has a whole bunch of other really good recipes, like this old-fashioned lemonade recipe is another we're going to do for Caitlin's shower. It is one of the best lemonade concentrates you will ever taste. It takes quite a bit of lemon. It takes 1 1/2 cups of lemon juice. And if you're gonna do it properly, you really should squeeze a lemon from scratch or half fresh lemon. I have used lemon, like the lemon concentrate juice before, and it does fine. But this is so good. It says this syrup makes enough for 14 glasses of lemonade. Basically what you can do, you can make this ahead of time, put it in a mason jar. And like for myself, if I want some really good lemonade, then you just take out whatever you want, add a little bit of water and ice to it, and you're good to go. You can also make it into a pink lemonade if you add just a grenadine syrup to the jar and shake. And I believe this is good for up to maybe a week, 2 weeks, something like that in the refrigerator. So that's just a fun little bit. And then we're going to be a little heavy on Anne of Green Gables today just because of the raspberry cordial and all of that. I got into a little bit of an Anne fix. I actually sat down and started reading the book again since I hadn't read it for quite a while. But I want to read you a little excerpt from the book about the raspberry cordial. Anne looked on the second shelf of the room pantry, but there was no bottle of raspberry cordial there. Search revealed it way back on the top shelf. Anne put it on a tray and set it on the table with a tumbler. "Now please, help yourself, Diana," she said politely. "I don't believe I'll have any just now. I don't feel as if I wanted any after all of those apples." Diana poured herself out a tumbler full, looked at the bright red hue admiringly, and then sipped it daintily. "That's awfully nice raspberry cordial, Anne," she said. "I didn't know raspberry cordial could be so nice. I'm real glad you liked it. Take as much as you want. I'm going to run out and stir the fire up. There are so many responsibilities on a person's mind when keeping house, isn't there?" When Anne came back from the kitchen, Diana was drinking her second glassful of cordial. And being entreated thereto by Anne, she offered no particular objection to drinking of a third. The tumbler fulls were generous ones, and the raspberry cordial was certainly very nice. The nicest I ever drank, said Diana. It's ever so much nicer than Mrs. Lynde's, although she brags about her so much. It doesn't taste a bit like hers. I should think that Marilla's raspberry cordial would be probably much nicer than Mrs. Lynde's, said Anne loyally. Marilla is a famous cook. She is trying to teach me to cook, but I assure you, Diana, it is an uphill work. There is no little scope for imagination in cookery. And that's basically the end of it. And if you do not know, Anne and Anne got Diana drunk, if you've never watched the movies or read the book. And unfortunately, it wasn't raspberry cordial that Diana was drinking. It was currant wine. I can see how maybe it could be misconstrued as one versus the other. So just a little bit of the books and things like that. But if you ever get a chance, seriously, it took me maybe 15 minutes to make at the most. And then, of course, I just let it chill overnight and it's super good. Tasty stuff. Now I have one more finished object, and it is an old finished object, but not that old. Pretty much everything that I've shown you that has been an old finished object has been finished since January, so it's been made within this year. I was out at Cowtown at Christmas time. We have a Christmas, Victorian Christmas every year. It's usually the first two weekends in December. And it was unseasonably warm this past year. I think it was like 40 or 50. And I'm a cold weather girl. I can definitely tolerate some cold. Usually I don't wear much more than just a very light fleece in the winter time. Now, if I'm outside for a long time, that's a different story. But I had made a really pretty mantle, excuse me, and I wore it because it was chilly. I mean, the wind was up and all of that, and kind of lends itself to the look of the dress at Christmas time and things like that. Well, I got awfully warm, so I needed something that wasn't a shawl, that was a little bit fancier, that I could wear with my fancy dresses at Christmas time and things like that. So I decided to make a cape, and I was going to do a full cape, but then I thought knitting a full cape might be a little heavy. And I have some wool to make an actual full cape, which I will probably do, and I'd rather use that as the full one, just because it would be a little bit more user-friendly, I think. But this is, there we go. I need one more clasp. I bought two, but I have no idea what I did with it. So I want another clasp, like right here. So let me put this on for you. I got the pattern off of Etsy. I looked on, because see, I think if I had one more clasp, this would lay much better here. So, but I think it'll be really warm. It kind of goes down to right about there, and then in the back, it cuts right, like right across the rump. So it will look very flattering, I think, and it will still show off the bustle if I have a bustle dress on, which most of mine do have a bustle. It was made out of acrylic, held double, super cozy. I have never blocked acrylic before, and I tried, because this wants to continue to curl in, even though I did a garter row, like ordered border, it still kind of wants to curl in right there. So I think I need to kill it some more, because I think that's what it's called, is when you kill the acrylic. But I think it's pretty. It's really not too heavy. It's quite comfortable. So we shall see what it will do this winter. And most of my winter garments are aubergine, or I do have a red dress too. That's one of my Christmas dresses. So purple will go well with all of that. And this is one of my favorite purple colors, but let me grab the pattern here. I won't show you everything on it, but it's called The Short Knitted Cape by M.E. Harrington, copyrighted of 2014. Her Etsy shop is hat and scarf patterns.etsy.com. I will post a link in the description bar below. So this is what hers looks like on. And then that is her finished object. And she used a ribbon to tie hers, but I thought it would be maybe a little bit more authentic if I used the clasp. And I have another one somewhere, but we'll have to see. Let's move on to my works in progress. I haven't really made much progress on anything. I just wasn't really in the mood, I guess. Last 2 weeks I was knit all the things. This week I was kind of like, yeah, I don't want to do anything. I have worked quite a bit on this one, but I ran into a snaggle with my second ball of Madeline Tosh. I'm not sure quite how this happened, but I just had to go ahead and cut it. I'm planning on swapping some mini skeins with people, so I figured I'd untangle this and use this to make the mini skeins. So this is my Musu shawl. It's a free pattern on Ravelry, and I'm still on the garter. I'm getting ready to start the yarn overs and things like that. I was planning on starting the yarn overs when I ran into the yarn barf. So I wanted to get a little bit past that. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 rows past that. So I think I'll go ahead and start on the other, but I'm sure that this is gonna block out really well and nice and big, and that's what I wanted. And I wanted something that was a little bit lighter weight. So it's Madeline Tosh is the yarn in Molly Ringwald. Super squishy, it's got lots and lots of gives, so I don't think it's gonna be any issue blocking it out. I'm really excited to see how the eyelet, well, I don't know if you call it eyelet, lace on the end of it's gonna turn out. So, and this is how much I have left of this skein. So quite a bit. I have almost a whole skein if I hadn't had yarn barf. So, and then this is in my Rosebud Spice tea set, the one that I made last week, the little teacup, so cute. I do have more fabric of this. I have a small one already cut out, but I need to get a couple more zippers. So I have zippers for bigger ones, but not for smaller ones. So, and then the other project, and I've actually worked quite a bit on that because maybe the last time we met, I was down here, something like that. So I actually worked quite a bit. So and then let's see. I need a table over here. Let's see. The next thing that is my work in progress, it went into timeout for a little while. I took it home with me to work on it at mom and dad's, and I haven't gotten very far. I think the last time you saw me was maybe bare. However, I have done this heel flap twice now, but I'm doing something wrong. I don't know what, but I'm doing something wrong. The heel flap, the Eye of Partridge, the modified Eye of Partridge heel flap, is just not turning out like I think it's supposed to. It doesn't have that texture on it that like the picture and stuff shows, the Hermione's Everyday. So I don't know. I'm gonna rip it out. So after I ripped it out once and worked it back in again, I looked at it and I'm like, it just does not look right. So then I ripped it out again and I worked it back in again. And mom's like, you're gonna rip it out again? And I was like, yeah, cause I don't have it right. I don't know what, and she's never made socks before, so she can't help me. I don't know. So I got fed up after I got this much done, cause I'm just about ready to do the heel turn. And I don't know. I love the yarn. Love the pattern. I love the texture of the Hermione's Everyday. And maybe it's supposed to look like this, and I just don't think it's looking correct. I have no idea. If any of you have ever done this heel flap, like the modified Eye of Partridge, let me know if I'm doing this right or not. That's partly why I decided to wait was and put it in timeout, because I was getting aggravated with it. And unfortunately, whenever that happens, sometimes I just need to step away. And I didn't really cast on anything else because I was at mom and dad's. So I just worked on my shawl and that was fine. And that is living in the same bag it's been in. It's the knitted sheep. They're knitting. They're so cute. So cute. And then let's see. I think I'm pretty much done with the knitting part. So if you guys want to say goodbye, that's fine. Thank you for sticking around to this point. The last few bits are going to be, I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the decorations that I've purchased for my kitchen. This is going to be a slow progress, but I still think it'll be fun to share it. And a few of you have said that you would be interested in seeing kind of what my ideas are for that. Now, I do have an idea for July for possibly a swap is what I'm thinking. I know that we're a pretty small group, but sometimes those are the most fun. I was thinking about celebrating Christmas in July. Just do something fun, something silly, nothing spectacularly big. I will get a little bit more. I was thinking about it yesterday and today about that it would be fun. I've always enjoyed Christmas, and hey, if that gives us a chance to listen to Christmas music 6 months early, why not? Let's do it. I figured what would happen is if you wanted to, I'd start a thread in the Ravelry group, and then we will, if you want to participate, just put your name in there. It's just going to be small, nothing large, maybe like a small skein of yarn, or if you want to swap some little things. If you have any ideas of what kind of swap that you would like to do, that would be great. Just let me know. You can put it in the chatter thread in the group, and that would kind of give me an idea of what you might like to do and things like that. Also, we would need to make sure that if you have our international followers, that you're okay either shipping within your country, or if you're okay shipping internationally. I know that shipping can be kind of expensive sometimes, so but it's still kind of fun to have I guess you could call them pen pals from another country send you something that you might actually have contact with. And maybe it would be something that, I know it's hard sometimes to come up with something that for Christmas in July, but you know, something that's important to you at Christmas time, or something that you use to celebrate Christmas in your own family way or something like that. If you don't celebrate Christmas and you still want to participate, that's okay too. We can always call it Hanukkah in July or Kwanzaa in July, whatever. If this is just a way for us to build a little bit greater community and things like that. So I will definitely put a chatter thread up probably, this will probably go up tomorrow, so I'll put it in the box down below or on our Ravelry group. So that way we can kind of all discuss if this is something you're interested in. I'll think about the semantics of it and let you know. So if you guys want to stick around, that's great. If not, I'm so happy that you came by and got to spend some time with me today. It's been a lovely, lovely afternoon with you. I do hope that you enjoyed the podcast, but other than that, I'm going to go ahead and move on into my kitchen decorations and things like that. So basically what I'm going to start off with is a few pictures from a couple magazines that I've looked at. I do have a Pinterest board for my kitchen. I'm a pinaholic. Let's just put it that way. I did have a couple friends that threw me a Pintervention because I was bad. Very, very bad. I have gotten much better with it. I am not nearly as much of a pinaholic as I was there for probably 2 or 3 years. I found other obsessions, primarily knitting, I think is primarily what it was, which was probably about January when I stopped having my pin all the things issues. So I do have quite a few pins on there. I will leave it a link for my Pinterest board down below for the kitchen. And if you want, you can follow it or you can follow me. Doesn't really matter. I do have various different things. If you like historical garments and things like that, I have oodles and oodles and oodles of those. I also have some different boards on there for the types of shows that I've done in the past. Kind of had my inspiration for those. So. But I will show you some pictures of kind of what I'm thinking of. My kitchen, I cannot paint except for cream. So, and the cabinets are white. And the man that lived here before me, he painted them like, just kind of like spray painted them. I'm not sure exactly what he did, but it's now starting to flake off. So I am going to have to take down the doors of the cabinets and I think scrape them and repaint them white. But I have never done that before. So I don't know if my landlord will be okay with it, but we're gonna do it anyway, and it's gonna make it look nicer. So I just, they're getting kind of dingy. So, and white is hard to keep clean no matter what you do, no matter how often you clean it, eventually it's gonna show dirt and grime. So, but let's get started with some of the pictures. I have two magazines here. The first one is Summer of 2015 Vintage Style. I happened to see the front cover of this, and I don't know if I would, maybe some of my tastes are vintage. I'd say more classic than vintage, but I loved the cover. I loved the pictures on the wall. I loved this yo-yo pillow. Oh, so cute. And then, whoops, sorry, I'm looking in the viewfinder. And then I loved this dress form on how they had that in the bottom part. I thought that was pretty cool. So let's see. I just have the pages marked that I liked. So let me get to it. I loved this. It's made out of some old books. And you cover a planter or a mason jar and then you fill it with flowers. I thought that would be adorable on the kitchen table. Especially if you got some fake peonies, which peonies are probably some of my favorite summer flowers, besides hydrangeas. I love hydrangeas, but I couldn't find any like pink ones or burgundy colored ones, so I had to go with the blue. It's nice to have fresh flowers every once in a while, even though I had some just last week. but I loved this idea. So I'm hoping to go some antiquing with a friend of mine that likes to antique as well. And maybe we'll find some old books that I can do this with. So then there's another one in here as well. I don't know why that one's marked. I don't know why I marked that one. Because it doesn't really have kitchen-y stuff. And then this, these window treatments here are made out of old fashioned hankies. And I love that idea. I have a big set of sliding glass doors on my kitchen. And currently I have basically napkins, which I took and I stitched together so they come down in a point. I know like there's four or five of them there. And I thought, I love them. They're easy to take down. And wash if I need to, if they get kind of gross and yucky and stuff like that. But I thought these little hankies would be so adorable, especially if I got them in the right colorways. And then they have one here that they made into a pillow. Is that just not too cute? I love it! So. And I know there's, in particular, there's one antique store over in Wichita that has a whole ton of antique hankies. So I wouldn't necessarily want to use hankies, even though maybe they've never been used, but it's just you know, like as real hankies. I know you can wash them, but ew. So that is a possibility. And then this is another one that I kind of like this table. This table here in the corner. I want something similar to that to put my microwave on. and stuff like that. So I don't know, we'll see. I think that's pretty much it in this one. I also kind of like this, like a 1950s kitchen. Yeah, where it has like the sugar and tea and all of that above the cabinets. I think that's cool. Those up there. So. This is going to be a long one today. I'm sorry, guys. I hope you don't mind. But, and then the second one that I looked at, it is from 2015, display until August 25 of 2015. And it's 100 Ideas of Flea Market Style. And I just picked it up and was flipping through it. So, let's see. I really liked the colorways that they have in this one. Now, this isn't kitchen related, but I love, and it's the same kind of thing as the last one, but this pillow that's got the yo-yos on it, and I love the print on this fabric. So I think that's partly why I marked that one, because I thought, well, that would be kind of a cute print to make cushions out of for the kitchen table. And then I really enjoyed, let's see, there's a print at Hobby Lobby that I like in like their decor fabric section that's kind of a bright pink, a teal, yellow, brown, but the print is very similar to, oops, you can't see that, it's very similar to this. But I like what they did here, where they actually took part of the fabric and then embroidered around it and put it in a frame, which I thought would be really cool as some wall art. And it's over here on the wall here. Is that not pretty? I thought that would be different and neat. And I loved this kitchen setup here. I liked this idea, and I like the color of that. I don't know, we'll see. And I think there's one more page that's marked, yes. And I love this wall here, like the print. And I just thought that would be interesting. And then this over here would be kind of cool to display all of my coffee mugs and stuff like that. I have several coffee mugs. I'm a collector of cups and things like that. So, and that's pretty much it for that, for the books. But, so let's get into the actual items that I have purchased. These are not any yarny goodness or anything like that, but they're fun nonetheless. The little bag that I showed you last week, which was made from recycled stuff, I got at the little coffee shop over in McPherson. I also picked up him, which is a little creamer, and he's a little elephant. Is he not just too cute? I do have quite a few elephants in my kitchen right now, and I will probably keep those. I have an elephant cookie jar that's like a green glass, and then an elephant, I think, salt and pepper shaker. Mmm, so good. Now, there was a store going out of business. It's one of our little local boutiques. It's been here for maybe 15 years or so. They had kind of decorations, clothes. It was set in Yoder, which is an Amish community, but we do have quite a few people off of the highway that stop there and things like that. Well, they were going out of business, and I just stopped in to see what was left, and they sold furniture in there too as well, but most of that had been gone. But everything was like 70 or 85% off, something like that. But I got this little jar, which I thought was this very sweet little apothecary jar. And it has little rabbits and a chick. It says, in the garden. I think this was an Easter item. and I think it was like 85% off. It was normally $19.98, and it was, I don't know, like $2 or $3. So I got that. I'm not exactly sure what I'm going to do with it. I might go on top of my cabinets. I'm not sure. But what I have in there right now is some of my hands, my very first hand spun yarn, which is not very good, but here's another one. That was, I think, my very first attempt. So, but I have it sitting up. I left the tag on it just so you guys could see it, but I had it sitting out. And it needed something in it, so I put my yarn balls in there. So, but I love it. I just think it is adorable. I don't think I'll probably put anything in it other than maybe like some fake lemons or something like that. I'm not sure, but. And then I got two other things here to show you. I want to do like a wall collage of different plates, maybe some embroidery hoops, kind of all circles or ovals with a few squares of paintings and things like that. There's a painting at our local coffee shop here in town. They display local artists' artwork and things like that in there for about 2 or 3 months at a time, and if you like it, you can buy it. There's one in there that I really love, and that would be beautiful in there. $75, not a whole lot, but right now in the summertime, my job isn't as busy because kids don't get as sick in the winter time or in the summertime as they do in the winter time. So sometimes we get called off quite a bit, and then plus I needed to save money, and everything extra that I have, I'm spending on Caitlin's bridal shower. So I still have money, but I don't see the point in paying $75 for a painting I don't necessarily need. So this was maybe a couple, at the same store, I'll go with that one next. At the same store where I got this little apothecary jar, they also had some like wall decor and stuff like that. And this one is called from Mud Pie, and it was $24.99. And I think it's a little like trivet, like you sit it and put like your hot stuff on there, because there's like little thingies, but they had it hanging on the wall, and I think that's what I'm going to do with it. But is that not just too cool with the forks and stuff? I thought it was cool. It's made in China, but that was pretty nifty. And I might use it for a trivet. I'm not sure, but yeah, so I thought that was cool. A little different, but. And then maybe a month or two ago, I was over at World Market, and no, I think it was probably around Easter time. I went to World Market over in Wichita, one of my favorite places to shop, actually, because you can find some unique and interesting things in there. And I was looking for a teapot, but I didn't find one that I liked, like just a regular ceramic teapot. I would love to have an old-fashioned one, but they're hard to find out here that aren't, either have a chip in them or something like that. I have a couple teacups that I'll probably put out in the kitchen as well, but I wanted something, you know, that was useful that I could use on a day-to-day basis, besides my little one that has a little cup underneath it. And then I have it's kind of fancy, but it's more of a coffee pot shape. It's not the little round teapot. And I wanted like a fun color, not just like the ones that you can get at Target or Walmart. So that's why I went into World Market. But they had some, I guess ceramic ware is what you would call it, on sale. And I got this plate, which I thought was cool. And it was on sale for $3.48. Can't beat it, right? But kind of the color, like the colorway that I'm thinking of going to. And then also, I don't have a picture of it right now, but I will insert it now. I want to make, this is actually on my project list for probably when I get done with this shawl, I might cast it on. It's a crocheted mandala, I think is how you pronounce it. And it is gorgeous. In one of these magazines, it had, it might be in one of these. No, it was my friend Maria. She was looking for some crochet magazines, and there was one in there, and it was super pretty. A little bit more 70s vibe than what I would like, but the one in the magazine. But I found this one on Ravelry, and I believe it's a free pattern. It's called Sophie's Garden, maybe? I think it's Sophie's Garden. And oh, it's so pretty. And I found the kit where I can buy all of the yarn at once for like $40. And it's just enough to, I think, finish whatever this is. But it's basically kind of like a doily, but you use DK weight yarn. So I thought that would be a good project, and it would add a little bit of color and tie everything together in the kitchen and things like that. So, but yeah, hopefully I'll be getting to work on that. I probably won't actually get to the actual decorating of it until maybe September or October, maybe even later than that. Who knows? We'll see. But I will keep you up to date.
I would like to talk to you a little bit about the Down to the Wire competition. We did actually get into the top 10. There were 27 teams involved. And the top 10 showcase was the Sunday after the actual filming. And we had about 800 people that came to the actual viewing of the movies and things like that. So lots and lots of fun. Unfortunately, I can't show you the movie like I had planned on until after the Tallgrass Film Festival, so that means that we will be part of the Tallgrass Film Festival. That's not until October. So, I can throw in a video of like clips and the things like that that we took over the 24 hours. So, it was lots of fun. Fun. I am honored, and I find it a privilege to work with the people that I work with whenever we get to do this and enjoy and share our common goal of creativity and things like that. I wish more people would have an appreciation for the Midwest and Kansas in particular, that we do have vision and forethought. Just because we're homegrown people doesn't mean that we don't have a vision or a quest or want to share our creativity with the world. So I was completely and utterly surprised by the type of movies that were put out there and the kind of movie that we did. I showed it to my sister-in-law and my brother over the weekend, and they said, it's almost like we're watching a movie that you could see on TV. So I felt very proud about that. So I really think that's probably about it. Let me check my basket of things down here and see what we've got left. Seriously, you gotta try that, it's so good. Well, I am so happy and thankful that you decided to join me again. I appreciate you sticking around. I hope you enjoyed your time. I hope you got a little bit of knitting done. I know this is a little long this time, but sometimes it's fun to have a little bit longer podcast, right? I do want to leave you with some parting notes. A few of the podcasts that I've been watching lately are that I just found. One is called Dairyland Knits, and his name is Josh, and I believe he's Auricula Josh on Ravelry, and he is so funny, and you can tell he's a kind and generous man. And then, let's see, what is the other one that I've been watching lately? I think maybe he's the only one new one that I've watched. Oh, the Subway Knits podcast. It's not a video one. It's just an audio one. And she is friends with Kristen from Volenvine Yarns. But the Subway Knit podcast, it's fun. She keeps it pretty quick paced. And, I mean, you can keep up with her and things like that. She's Greek, so she speaks about Greek mythology and things like that, which is kind of cool. And she lives in... I believe Queens, New York, either Queens or Brooklyn, one or the other. I would definitely recommend any of those podcasts that I mentioned. They are excellent and wonderful. I hope that you guys stay cool or warm, whatever hemisphere you might be in. And I would like to send knitted hearts from my house to yours, and I hope you guys have a great day. Take care. Bye.